Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me back home to the Humanities to speak to the Humanities from so many countries at the same time. I will speak critically about the representation of the Humanities in performance indicators. I will also be a bit constructive, so let us not just discuss what is unacceptable, but perhaps also discuss what could be acceptable as a representation of the scholarly standards and publishing practices of the humanities if we were to become more visible and competitive. So I will start by talking about internationalization. It is not an easy theme to discuss in the humanities, but it has also to do with the representation in performance indicators. I will discuss this in combination with the societal impact of the humanities because I think these two themes need to be discussed together and not as opposed to each other. Then I will describe the scholarly publication practices and ask questions, for example, is the book going away? Is the native language publishing going away? What do we want to happen? Then I will describe the limited coverage of the commercial data sources of the humanities. It is important to describe these deficits with empirical data in order to proceed. And then I will point out some possible strategies for improved visibility and competitiveness. So starting with internationalization, I shall talk about language. It's a difficult theme. This union has two official languages, and there might be other international languages in the humanities. This is a conference coming up in early August at the University of Vienna. As you can see, the announcement is in Latin. It is not in English primarily. It is the International Conference of the International Association for Neo-Latin Studies. It reminds us that humanities were international. They were international within an elite. They were even more international than they are today, and Neo-Latin was the international language. It also reminds us that humanities were not only searching for identity, but also appreciated otherness. There was even a love of languages. So this one area of research stands out of an international tradition. It is the humanities. So what's the problem? Well, I will turn to that. This conference has, in fact, six official languages. It has five modern languages in addition to Latin. At the last conference in Münster in Germany, the president would welcome us all in all six languages, not by repeating one small talk in all languages, but by having one large talk and changing language five times. That's really the ideal of the humanities. How does it work today? Well, in the invitation to this year's conference, they say, papers can be given in any of the official languages, but please be aware that at this meeting, papers not delivered in English attract a much smaller audience than those that are. And I can tell you that 3 years ago, the situation was the same in Münster, sadly. So we need to think about that. I have asked myself, what is the international languages in humanities? And then from a Norwegian point of view, because I know that the point of view can be different from different countries. So in humanities in Norway, English is regarded as the international language, but with these important exceptions. Of course, in the philological disciplines, the language of the study object is practiced as an international language in addition to English. And this is important because we will never change that in the humanities. In the philological disciplines, they will always also have the language of the study object as an international language. And if we can accept that and make it an ideal continuously, I think we can solve some of the problems in the language discussions. Then most older scholars in Norway, they will read other international languages as well, such as French and German. But in the next generation, we cannot see this to be the same. Mostly they will only read and write English as an international language if they are not in the philological disciplines. That is the situation. So it seems that we have to accept that English has become the today's Neo-Latin in most of the disciplines of the humanities, at least from our point of view. But this question of the international language needs to be discussed in relation to the societal impact of the humanities. So why did we leave Neo-Latin? It was because of the Enlightenment, it was because of the building of the nation state, it was because of democracy, it was because of the democratization of higher education, it was because of the knowledge-based society. We cannot return from that. So we need to keep speaking to society. Now, how do the sciences speak to society? Up left, you have the main export of Norway, it's the oil. Then you have the second largest export, it's the fish, aquaculture. Both of these two are heavily science-based, but you can see no scientists there. And the science behind these industries are not published openly to society. They are published in specialized journals. And from these journals, the knowledge is transferred into these technologies. So the sciences are invisible in this respect. On the other hand, the humanities speak directly to society, and they do so in the native languages. Even in translations, they speak to society. So the native languages today are the languages of the societal relevance and impact of the humanities. This is another example. This is the science leading to the contraceptive pill. In the 1920s, it was all there in scientific journals that were only for specialists. Then you could see some of the development appear in applied journals and in mission-oriented research programs. And then the fields are united and you could see the contraceptive pill implemented in 1960. But still, science was only speaking to society through that pill. After that came all the humanities and social sciences studies reporting on the cultural and social effects of the pill. So we are there all the time, talking to society. As you can see here, the humanities and social sciences have a higher propensity to publish for a general audience than the sciences have, and also to contribute to public debate. So the societal relevance of the humanities is highly dependent on using the native language in direct contact with the general public, and also, of course, with the school system. If we take that away from the humanities, we're taking away many reasons for the humanities being there at all. And of course, then, non-scholarly outputs normally are included in research evaluations and should be, just like here in the Netherlands. But what is missing still in many countries, also in the Netherlands, is a systematic data sources for the evidence of such activity and publications. I now conclude with the first two points. The re-internationalization, I call it, provides international scholarly communication. It stimulates research quality among specialists. And it selects English as the international language in most fields. And it enhances research themes of international relevance. So these are positive developments, but there are also limitations. And societal impact takes care of the rest. It depends on us as generalists, as educators, as communicators. It selects the native language, and it enhances research themes of national or regional importance. So this means that researchers in the humanities need to publish in at least two languages if we are not English-speaking from the start. That's simply the situation. Now, the scholarly publication patterns, this will be a more empirical part, because I'm demonstrating this from a large database of more than 100,000 scholarly publications in Norway. And this is the growth rate. So when I show percentages after this, you know that behind these percentages, there's growth. So for example, when we study the percentage publications in the national language, you can see that this percentage is going down in humanities social sciences. But in fact, the number of publications is still increasing in the native languages. But the increase is higher in publications in international languages. Here we also see the different roles. The health sciences also use the native languages in the professional journals where they have scientific articles. And this is why we all have journals of the medical association in each country publishing in the native language. You want to outreach to those audiences of practitioners. While the science and technology almost never publish in the native language. But this division, half and half, takes care of the double roles of the humanities and social sciences in society, both to be international and to address the national context. Now, if you ask the researchers in the same database whether they publish in the international language or the national language, they say that they do both. These add up to more than 100%. So almost 80% of the researchers will publish within 1 year in an international language, but at the same time, 65% will publish in the Norwegian language. They do both, just as I said. Now to the publication types. We all know that articles and books take up larger shares of the production in the humanities and social sciences, contrasting to the journal publishing in the sciences. And this is a picture that does not change much. There are slight increases in the propensity to publish in journals, but still, this graph shows that book publishing remains very, very important in the humanities. It does not seem to change. And why? I think it is because it is so that deep down in our methodologies, these publication formats respond to different tasks and different methodologies, and we need them all to go together in our research. If we should publish only in journal articles, some of our most important methodologies would go away. It's not just a question of publication format. That's my explanation of the relative stability. And as you see also, if we ask the researchers in the database, they do all of this. Most researchers will both publish articles in books and articles in journals. And quite many will also publish a book within a two-year period. Now, this is about citations. That was touched upon also in the first presentation today. It shows simply, we compare with a medical field, and then we show that the references are older and older on average, the farther out you go into the humanities. So the average citation in history is 23 years back, which means that you can't really count citations after 3 years. Then only a small part of the citations go to other journal articles. Why, here in gastroenterology, it's almost all references. And then if you look at the coverage of the reference in Web of Science journals, the percentage are even lower. And this explains why the average citation rate is so small. And this numbers means that citation measure might be valid in economics, but they will be questionable in sociology and they will not be valid in the humanities. They will not be valid in the humanities because we are measuring something that seldom exists within this time window of citations. Now, about productivity, I'd just like to show you that if we count publications per researcher per year, the humanities seem to be less productive than the sciences. This is the average number of publications within 2 years. But here we are double counting all those papers where several authors are publishing together. If we don't count them, double count, but count only one publication once, the humanities are more productive. So there must be something wrong with both measures. And here is the measure that levels it out. This just tells us that, you know, these are complete records. Here, the book publications are included here also, but it's only peer-reviewed publications. It just says us that if we have a proper data source and if we have a proper counting method, there's no real productivity differences between these areas of research. And in that way, the humanities could become just as visible as they should be in a kind of bibliometric appraisal. So I conclude that researchers in the humanities are normally bilingual in their scholarly publications, scholarly publishing, and I have told you why. That this scholarly journal publishing and book publishing supplement each other because they represent different methodologies and forms of organization in research. Citation indicators are, as a rule, not valid in the humanities. And the productivity and visibility of the humanities depends much on the data source and the counting method. And now for the coverage and the commercial data sources. This is the database that I have been using so far, and these are the representations within Scopus and Web of Science of the same publications. It goes down to 20 and 10%, 30 and 10% in humanities. And both of them, both commercial databases, have the same pattern of representation. So one is not simply better than the other, because they are based on the same idea of indexing core journals. They have started indexing book, but we get the same picture here as well. So there's incomplete coverage of international journals. There's very limited coverage of books, and there's random or no coverage of the national level in books and journals. I measured this for all the humanistic disciplines. On the average, about half of the publications in humanities are in journals. Of these, 52% of the articles are in international language, but still only 23% and 32% of these are covered by Web of Science and Scopus. And this is not because there's something wrong with Norway. It's the representation of all countries in the humanities in the Web of Science. Even if we go to the United States or Netherlands, we will have much the same situation. Now to the strategies to end with. There was this project, perhaps you remember it, some years ago. It was initiated by the European Science Foundation in collaboration with four of the largest research councils in Europe. And it ended with this report where they pointed at some possibilities, and there it stopped. But I think there are still things to do. So how did we get to 100%? Well, we have this national current research information system that the universities and other research institutions share as a national system. And it works as a kind of electronic system for producing annual reports. So in the system is what we would like to report when the, at the institution level when the year is ending. So for example, this database knows that I'm here to speak about this topic today because I told the database that I'm here today. So it knows what I do if I tell it. Now, we are also able to measure all kinds of publications, but the scholarly publications are taken especially care of. I had two publications these 2 years in Web of Science journals, and these references are imported. I just need to validate them. But the point is that I can add my other publications to make up 100% of my scholarly production those 2 years. So the current research information system allows us all to have complete records of what we actually publish. So it gives the bibliographic references of my book and my article in a book, but it doesn't tell you what this book is about. But I will tell you right now. It's a study of a comedy that was written in Denmark in the early 18th century. It's about a peasant that gets drunk and ends up as being the rain of his small commune. He believes that he is the rainer, but then he gets drunk again and then he's detronized, like in a carnival, to his former life. Now, this comedy was written on the basis of the main story in a novel that was written in Lepton in early 17th century in southern Germany. And this author was born in Ingen and died in Rome 1639. But now this is taking me far away from what I'm supposed to speak about here, so I'll return to a newer map. National CRIS systems I told you about is one of the solutions that could bring the humanities forward in this respect. And we started this doing this in Norway 2005, but as you can see now, it has spread out. And in the discussion in Portugal last year when I was present, they had first investigated Web of Science as a possible way of documenting the output from the universities. Then they found out that Scopus might have larger coverage. But then they let the universities go into this and they could not see there a full representation of what universities were actually doing. So they decided on this same solution. That's one strategy. Another is, of course, to keep this national system, we have to have a dynamic register of scientific journals and publishers. Note that it also has a register of scholarly book publishers. Now, since we have talked about ERI, and it has all been already mentioned that it has moved now for its management to Norway, it is because this capacity was already there. So they know how to manage a dynamic register of journals. But we knew that these quality tiers were so controversial and so inconsistent that they could not be used on an international level. So this is a kind of dynamic, quality-assured register of journals in the humanities and social sciences that can be used in a country for these kinds of ratings, but it's not in itself meant to provide for those ratings. It is meant to provide for good national current research information system and as also as a reminder to Scopus and Web of Science of what they are not covering. So it's already there, it's up and going, and at the end of this week there will be a starting conference in Bergen, international conference launching the new version. Conclusions. Well, I think the re-internationalization and the societal responsibilities of the humanities should be combined in practice and not set up against each other. And this has consequences for performance indicators. If we want to have this combination and make the humanities visible in both respects, then we can see that researchers in humanities normally published in more than one language and in more than one publication format. And this is because they need to, because thereby they realize their specific research methodologies, their specific standards for international scholarly communication, and their specific forms of societal impact. Then we can see that the coverage of humanities in commercial data sources is variable among the disciplines and very limited in some of them. And it's causing a notion of visibility and research quality which depends on commercial investments in large companies. And I think this is altogether unacceptable. In addition to that, and we never talk about this, but it also leaves the humanities with limited tools for information retrieval in the libraries, which these databases has the primary aim to provide. So if these commercial solutions are limited, why are not the research libraries providing us with better research tools on the international level? Then I think visibility of the humanities would mean a complete recognition and documentation of all the specific forms of societal impact, which is possible in a current research information system, and also all the peer-reviewed scholarly publications in different formats and languages, which is also possible. Okay, thank you very much.